I believe a dark tidal wave is on the horizon. It's a wave of hostility and persecution that is about to crash onto the church. We have been conditioned not to expect persecution. It's because I know how dangerous, how difficult persecution can be, that I have such a sense of urgency for the United States. I'm focusing on preparation of the heart to be faithful till the end. Hello, everyone. I've talked about the risks of fear and offense and how they can knock us out if we're not prepared when hardship hits. In this session, I'll talk about another significant risk, which is pleasure seeking. That when pressure comes, we can throw ourselves into the pursuit of pleasure, which is often an attempt to escape or self-medicate. In fact, medical research has shown that our brains are hardwired to seek distraction when under pressure. I read that when the brain is flooded with the stress hormone cortisol, the reward center of the brain is excessively activated and looks for hedonic stimuli. And these can be chemical, like drugs, alcohol, sugar, or they can be behavioral stimuli, sexual immorality, pornography, entertainment, social media, gambling, shopping, binging on food, basically anything that allows us to escape, to ignore, to bury our heads in the sand. It's not surprising that a number of these areas saw significant increase during the prolonged pressures of the COVID pandemic. Jesus warns believers about this danger. And again, this is in a context of persecution and increasing pressure. He says, "But watch yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and cares of this life, and that day come upon you suddenly like a trap." This risk area of pleasure seeking is even more pronounced in our culture. There are some very good American values, but there are some very godless American values as well. Think of the messaging that comes out of Hollywood. Of course, everybody in the world wants to be happy, but here the attitude is almost, we deserve it. We have the right to avoid hardship. I suggest that the pursuit of pleasure and self-actualization or self-fulfillment is for many people their controlling value. This basically means I do what makes me feel good. My feelings and desires determine my path and my truth. When I encounter hardship, I retreat to a safe place because part of taking care of myself is the avoidance of suffering. And this way of thinking has crept into the church. Many Christians think, God wants me to be happy. Well, yes, but that's only part of the picture. The way of Jesus is very different. He expects me to accept suffering voluntarily for his sake. In fact, he says very clearly that hardship is part of the cost of following him. I can't do what I feel like doing. I have to do what he wants. There's no safe place to which I can retreat. When I encounter hardship, I need to persevere through it unless the Lord delivers me. My real safety lies in heaven. So the underlying values of our culture are in opposition to the requirements of Jesus. And this makes the message of perseverance under pressure especially important. Some years ago, my friend Catherine exclaimed as she prayed for me, "Andrew, you will be known for perseverance." And I immediately thought, oh no, I would much rather be known for something else, for miracles, for many people coming to Jesus, for whatever, but please, not perseverance. Because perseverance by definition means enduring in the midst of difficulties. Several years later, when I ended up in prison and I started to break, I remembered this word about perseverance and I started to press into it in prayer. Oh God, build perseverance in me, because I really, really needed it. When my mother was allowed to visit me early in my detention, I sat across from her crying, "Look, Mom, look what they've done to me. My heart's broken. I can't stop weeping. This is so hard, I can't handle it." "Well, of course you're crying. Of course this is difficult," said my mom. "This is suffering. If it weren't painful, it wouldn't be called suffering." I had a much more difficult time in prison than I would have expected. I thought grace would make a bigger difference. whatever level of grace I did have, I was still overwhelmed with weakness, grief, loneliness, fear. I thought of Jesus, how an angel ministered to him when he was in agony in the Garden of Gethsemane. And I thought, if only an angel would minister to me, I'm sure it would make a huge difference. But Noreen pointed me to the following verse. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. This was after the angel strengthened him. So even after an angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him, Jesus still had a very, very difficult time. And if it was difficult for him, then I shouldn't be surprised that it's difficult for me. And this is why building perseverance was so important for me. And it's important for you. With the pressures and difficulties that are coming our way, we need a mindset of perseverance so that we can remain faithful. As I read the Bible in prison, I noticed that Jesus had a lot to say about persevering and enduring. In the Gospels, he tells his disciples, "You will be hated by everyone because of my name, but the one who perseveres to the end will be saved." He also says, "By your endurance, you will gain your lives." To the churches of Asia Minor, the seven churches of Revelation, Jesus says that only those who overcome, that is, those who endure, will receive his promises. To the church at Smyrna, and this is where I myself was imprisoned, Jesus said, "Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life." There are many other verses like this throughout the New Testament, warnings given in a context of persecution. I want to highlight a few truths about perseverance. First, perseverance is a decision of the will. Recently, one of my sons was going through the selection process for an elite military group, and they pushed the men to the breaking point physically. In fact, they want to see what the men will do when they're physically exhausted. Will they push on or give up? My son pushed his body so hard, he ended up with a heat stroke, 108 degree core body temperature. But he kept running through the delirium until he fell to the ground unconscious. The mental determination had kept him going after his body was past the breaking point. Paul encourages Timothy to have the mentality of a soldier as he exhorts him to follow Paul's own example in being willing to undergo persecution. And this is the mentality that I had to develop in prison. I think of my first year in prison as one of breaking and the second as a year of rebuilding. I described in an earlier session that the turning point came when I made a decision to fight for my relationship with God because I was very close to failing. I said, "I will run after you, Jesus. And if I can't run, then I will crawl. I will follow you no matter what." This was not driven by emotions. I had just been transferred to a maximum security prison. Things did not look good. My feelings were in turmoil. This was a decision driven by the will. Now, after this initial decision, I was still weak. I still felt beaten down, so I had to persist in this decision day after day. Perseverance is all about making decisions with the will, often in complete contradiction to how I feel. And this requires determination, intentionality, discipline. Here's what it looks like. I mentioned earlier how Paul says in Philippians that everyone looks out for their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. What if the interests of Jesus are best served by my remaining in prison? I knew that God wanted me to surrender in this area, and so I began a daily battle of surrender. I would wake up in the morning with fear and despair and begin to fight to get to that point where I could say, "I am willing to remain in prison if it serves your purposes." Usually, I'd get to that point by the end of the day and experience a measure of peace. The next morning, I would wake up with the same fear and desperation and start the battle over again. But as I flex the surrender muscle, as I flex the perseverance muscle day after day, this built a determination and a strength in me so that I emerged from prison stronger than when I went in. And this underlines a second point. Perseverance is not a one-time decision. It's a decision that needs to be persisted in again and again and again. Now, when I say this, I want to make clear, I am not a highly disciplined person at all. This really did not come easily to me. I had to work at it. I had to exert myself. A third truth is that as I do this, as I persevere with my will repeatedly over a period of time, it builds something in me. It forms that in which I am persevering. This was true for a number of the disciplines I've described that helped to rebuild me in my relationship with God. For example, I disciplined myself to worship around half an hour a day. I often didn't feel like doing it. I did it because it was right that I worship. But as I persisted in worship, this built a determination in me to worship in all circumstances. Also, I forced myself to dance day after day in the cold and the heat and the rain. I did it as a matter of obedience. And as I persisted, this built a greater determination to obey. This is what finally forced me from my bed after the devastation of learning that the Turkish government wanted to give me 3 life sentences. And so I danced, even in my grief. And my obedience grew deeper and stronger and came more easily. I determined to sing my heart song, the song I wrote for Jesus in prison. And I sang it every day. And as I sang it again and again, that I wanted to live for the day I stand before Him, I actually began to live for that day. Over time, a fear of God and an eternal perspective grew in me. This is how it works. Make a decision, stand and persist in that decision, and something actually starts to form inside of you. I want to show you what perseverance produced in me. Toward the end of July 2018, I had already been through 3 trial sessions in a kangaroo court, and in spite of tremendous U.S. government pressure, I was still sitting in prison, just wilting in the heat. I was not encouraged. In my Bible reading program, I came to John 18:12. And Peter is resisting the arrest of Jesus. And Jesus says to him, "Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me?" Those words echoed in my mind again and again over the next few days. This is part of the letter I wrote to Noreen. This sentence keeps resonating in my mind as I go through the daily, sometimes hourly struggle of submitting myself. Beyond that, of intentionally embracing whatever God's plans are that have allowed for ongoing imprisonment. Shall I not drink the cup? I want to drink the cup faithfully to the dregs. But then I also say, Lord, I've been drinking this cup for close to 2 years. How much longer? But may I be faithful to the end. May I be willing to drink the cup, to continue drinking it. How could I do otherwise? I want to be an obedient son. This was the last letter I wrote in prison, totally unaware that the very next day I would be released suddenly to house arrest. A little over a year earlier, I had arrived at this maximum security prison, a broken man. But now I was willing to drink the cup of suffering. I didn't come to this point in a day or two. It was a result of a long perseverance. So how do we learn to persevere? How do we build a persevering mentality? Early in my detention, someone sent me a message. Tell Andrew, all the times he has stood are for now. I wanted to hear something different, like Andrew will be released very soon. But I came to value this word. I came to realize that every time I had faced hardship in the past and pressed through and endured, this had built a measure of strength in me. And then would come another hardship and build me some more. And all of these had prepared me in some way for the terrible test of prison. And then I repeated this cycle in prison. Every time I was crushed and got up again, it built perseverance a bit deeper in me, layer upon layer. There was a cumulative effect as I took small steps day after day. And this is my point. You build perseverance by doing it. Start by being faithful in the small things now. Sometimes we think of the big cost. I'm ready to die for Jesus. And we say we're ready to pay it. But often we don't think of paying the smaller cost, the cost day after day that's not as dramatic. But this is what prepares us to pay the big cost when it comes. Jesus underlined that the one who is faithful in the small things will be faithful in the larger things. Pray for the grace of endurance. The truth is that underlying all our efforts is God's faithfulness. We could not endure on our own, and He doesn't ask us to. Ultimately, He carries us through, and we should rest in this. But let's not minimize that He expects us to exert ourselves to persevere, and that this can be very difficult and push us to our limits and even beyond. We must commit ourselves to persevere. I want to end by praying for you what I prayed for myself and for my family so many times in prison. Father God, pour out on your sons and daughters the courage, the strength, the confidence, the hope, the endurance, the steadfastness, and the perseverance of Jesus, that we may run the race set before us and finish well. A beautiful bride, purified in the fires of faithful obedience, tested and found worthy of her beloved, of Jesus, the King of glory. Amen. I invite you to join me in the next session, where I'll talk about the danger of deception and some strategies God is giving to protect ourselves and the church.